under typical, which of course is a statistical notion which is quite foreign to NLP practice in my opinion. In a typical context in business, there is a explicit, overt attempt by all parties to manipulate the internal maps and behaviors of the rest. If that same ethic were allowed in the case of training and application with clients who are undergoing significant personal changes, even Freud recognized over 100 years ago that to allow the imposition of the perceptions, the values, the beliefs of the analyst onto the client was a fundamentally unethical transaction. In particular, because when a person is making a change, they step into the unknown, they're extremely vulnerable, they're quite sensitive and suggestible, looking for a reference point in the unknown zone that they've stepped into. The relationship of rapport, which I will presuppose is a requirement to be successful in this change work, indicates that the most available reference point, in fact, is exactly the analyst or the agent of change in other contexts. So the analyst or the agent of change has a special responsibility to not make an imposition of their perceptions, beliefs, and values. This is almost an impossible task, but it's one worth struggling to achieve. It's very clear that if I watch and listen to somebody make an emotional response to some provocation or some stimuli that comes up in the environment or internally to them, and I then name the state that I guess that they're having the intensely kinesthetic experience in, I am now imposing. So there are very clear cases of imposition. There are cases that are less clear. But the context matters enormously. Even in the business context, if I succeed by a pattern interruption or a very forceful presentation of an idea that's not congruent with some other person's proposal, in creating this state of vulnerability, then I will, using calibration, take the responsibility for backing off of this imposition, which under normal circumstances in business is part of the free marketplace of ideas, the competitive activities within a corporation and between the marketplace and the corporation to promote their services and products. I see no problem with being fully effective in imposing content, except in the special case in business where you recognize by calibration this has actually put the person in a vulnerable state where they are not capable of exercising their critical screening competencies to filter out inappropriate impositions of beliefs, values, and perceptions. I will take it that under normal circumstances, this constraint is not a constraint that has to be respected in business, except in the special case where, for whatever accidents of context, a person has entered one of these highly suggestible and vulnerable states. However, on the flip side, in training and in the application as an agent of change, I regard this as a very special responsibility. If you can't make the distinction between process and content, go someplace and learn it, but quit imposing these things consciously or unconsciously on your clients. You have absolutely no right to make this imposition. On the other hand, in order to know whether you're doing this or not is itself a whole question about sensitizing yourself to the training and to the application of agent of change patterns. There is another interesting thing here, which might be useful. You do impose content. You do impose the actual processes. That is, of the many patterns I could choose to apply in a training or a change context, I have many choices. When I pick, and the one I pick will be, in that sense, a content imposition. Seems to be me in these contexts of training and personal change work, that's exactly what's being requested. What is an effective process by which I can create choice for myself? So at that level, the actual manipulation of the process leads to a context where choice becomes plentiful. It's easy to know in many cases the imposition of content actually reduces choice. The classic anchoring formats are kind of amusing to me. in the sense that typically you take an unhappy robot and you convert them into happy robots. Certainly from the point of view of the client is a net gain in quality of life and effectiveness in the world, but it's hardly a generative approach to change. This, of course, leads me to comment that this characterization of the new code as this collision between high-performance states and context is exactly a context in which the impositions are minimized, both at the level of process and at the level of content.